Thank you so much. And thank you for this invitation to speak at this forum. I'm an assistant professor at Stanford, as I said, and my lab is interested in understanding how gene regulation works and especially its connections with chromatin. And the approaches that we take are looking at many by varying one parameter at a time, and we use what I call high throughput synthetic biology. Then in parallel, we look at a few kind of in depth with single cell, single molecule approaches over time. And we use this information to really build better tools to control genes. And I'm gonna try to give you an intro to how chromatin and gene regulations are connected, and then kind of take you through this with one example through all these three steps. I'm excited to be here and talking to trainees as well. I really like mentoring and teaching, so thank you for inviting me to be part of this forum. And as many of you know in the audience, I would say all cells in the human body have the same DNA, but all of our cell types, our brain cells, our skin cells, our heart cells have different genes that are on or off, and that makes them function differently. And part of what changes gene expression in the cell type is that transcription factors and chromatin states are different, and that controls which genes are on or off. So I'm trying to kind of show here in a simplified manner how that could happen and how they are connected. So near the promoter or enhancers of genes, you have binding sites for transcription factors, activators, let's say, that can recruit transcriptional machinery and drive transcription of those genes. However, our human DNA is packed into chromosomes, which are made of histones and DNA. And actually, the chromatin can be modified. And if it's modified by activators, it can create a permissive or active state of chromatin that allows this binding of activators and transcriptional machinery. And conversely, there are transcription factors that are repressors that come and change the state of chromatin by adding repressive modifications such as DNA methylation, but other histone modifications, as you heard this morning, to create this repressive chromatin state called heterochromatin that then will restrict access to both activators and transcriptional machinery. And the nice thing about this chromatin modifications is they are long-lived and they have positive feedback, so they can persist in cells beyond the initial stimulus, and therefore they're associated with what is called epigenetic memory. And because transcription factors and chromatin regulators and this epigenetic memory are responsible or to a big part for sort of cell identity, they're extremely important to understand, both for understanding processes in basic biology, such as development or immune response to viral infections, but also to build applications for genetic, epigenetic, or cellular therapies for us to be able to control human genes that are misregulated better, or to just reprogram cells to do other functions. In order to understand all of this and engineer new transcription factors, what we need to do is first understand them. So let me zoom in here on kind of how transcription factors look like. So transcription factors consist of DNA binding domains, which are this blocky thing shown on the bottom, that recognize specific transcription factor binding sites, their DNA sequences, and then some other part of the protein called an effector domain. That's kind of the business end of the protein that can be an activator or repressor. And those effector domains either recruit transcriptional machinery, as I told you, or chromatin regulators that change the state of chromatin. And in human cells, there are about 1,600 transcription factors. And I urge you to take a look at this really beautiful review from 2018, kind of cataloging them by their DNA binding domains, which are much better understood because they are well-structured and conserved. What we're actually more interested in my lab, and it's kind of a new focus in the field, is how these effector domains work. In particular, what are the protein domains in human cells that can activate or repress transcription? What makes a good transcriptional activator or repressor? And when I started my lab, we were missing more than half of the transcript of the 1600 human transcription factors were missing annotation on whether they have an activation or repressor domains, even though their DNA binding domain was annotated, and they were known to have a role in gene expression. So we were interested in figuring out, do they have activation or repression domains, what their sequences were in the protein is that. And a classical assay to characterize transcription factor domains, both activators and repressors, is to recruit this candidate effector domains and their mutants and reporter genes. So this assay was pioneered in the 1980s, and it simply consists of fusing your candidate activator or repressor. In this case, I'm showing an activator to a DNA binding protein that you can then recruit to a promoter that drives the expression of a fluorescent protein. So for example, you can start with the cells having no fluorescence, and as you recruit different activators domains as we go to the right, you can get higher and higher level of this fluorescence, which in this case is citrine. Conversely, you can test for repressors if you recruit them at the promoter that starts on, shown here, and then as you recruit stronger and stronger repressors, you get more and more of the cells to be turned off until all of the cells are completely off. So for each of these distributions that I'm showing you, we had to spend weeks, sometimes months, making a single cell line that stably has the reporter in and has each transcription factor, this synthetic kind of transcription factor fusion delivered by lentivirus. So that's already kind of quite a lot of cell lines, but there are 1600 transcription factors and they have many pieces if you want to try all the pieces and all mutants. So we can't do this one at a time. As I started my lab, we developed this new workflow to measure actually candidate effector domains in a pooled manner, 10,000 or 100,000 at a time. And it still relies on a fluorescent reporter. We added kind of a surface marker to turn it into a magnetic reporter. And we recruit candidate effector domains at this reporter like you do in the classical assays. But now we synthesize, we sort of order and deliver with lentivirus a library of fusions between the synthetic DNA binding domain and candidate effector domain such that each cell contains a single effector domain. And then we separate the cells that are on from the cells that are off. And we simply ask quantitatively, which sequences are enriched in the off population? Those must be repressors. And which sequences are enriched in the on population? Those must be activators. And we spend a fair amount of time kind of calibrating this sequencing-based assays with the flow cytometry assays, actually building calibration curves to make sure that we get quantitative results back. So with this assay in hand, that was actually, I forgot to say, developed, but one of my first students, Josh Tycho, in collaboration between my lab and Mike Basick's lab at Stanford. With this assay in hand, we then started looking across all of the human transcription factors. So for each transcription factor, whose sequence is shown here on the bottom, we tested 80 amino acids, little fragments of it, and recruited it either at the minimal promoter to ask, is that little fragment an activator, which is what is shown here on the y-axis, or is this little fragment a repressor, which is shown as the off-to-on score. And indeed, as you can see for this MIB transcription factor, we can recover the annotated, the activation domain that was annotated in UniProt and the repressive domain that was annotated in UniProt. So some transcription factor have their activation and repressive domains annotated together with their DNA binding domain that doesn't give us any signal, of course, in our assay because we replaced the DNA binding domain with our own inducible DNA binding domain. So we did this exercise in one pot for 140,000 sequences that tile across 2,000 proteins, 1,600 transcription factors and 400 chromatin regulators. And what we found was a few hundred activation domains and over 1,000 repressive domains over which 700 or so were new. And actually very few were annotated in UniProt shown here in gray. And most of the ones that were known, we had actually kind of annotated or sort of analyzed in a previous paper in the one where we developed the technique in 2020. And I'll come back to them. These repressive domains are mostly crabs. I'm not going to show 2,000 of these tiling plots, but there is a 2,000-page supplementary information. It's not actually extended data figure. So Nature has this extended data figure. It's called supplementary figure 2. So you can take a look at your favorite transcription factor if you have one that you care about. But what I'm going to try is to summarize the results from that. So with this method for testing 10,000 or 100,000 protein domains, which you can apply to your favorite process, we used it to really annotate activators and repressors in human and actually in viral proteins as well. And what we found is the following. For activation domains, 99% of the sequences necessary for activation are a mix between hydrophobic residues, acidic residues, negatively charged DNAs, and a sprinkle of serines, prolines, and glutamines. And this is consistent with this idea of acidic and hydrophobic composition of activation domains that was proposed by Tijan's group, Barakon's group, Miko Taipales, and more recently by Han group, Kornberg, and Stark groups. And I guess I will refer to them as greasy acidic noodles because they are hydrophobic, greasy with acidic residues and with this salt, pepper, and queso. So these are activators, but I think repressors are a lot more interesting. There are many more flavors, but I would say the dominant category, there are 400 of them, are these crabs, the crab domains, and I'm going to spend the rest of the time that I have talking about them. We also found surprising the hundreds of repressive domains that contain sumoylation motifs, which suggests there is a big sumoylation and sumo interaction network in human cells. Interestingly, sumo goes up with stress and viral infection. We don't quite understand this network yet, so we are kind of digging deeper into that. But now let me talk a bit more about crabs, which are more interesting than noodles. A few of the crabs were known before. In fact, they were used as part of CRISPR-I. And let me talk about CRISPR-I a little bit. So the CRISPR-I is a fusion between this programmable DNA binding domain, which is sourced from CRISPR. So if you take CRISPR, which normally cleaves DNA and deactivate it to get the Cas9, you can use it as the DNA binding domain that will bind at whatever gene you send it by giving it the right guide RNA that will recognize the target DNA. And if you fuse it to this effector domain, such as transcriptional repressors or transcriptional activators, you can make a synthetic repressor or activator. And in fact, in work that was done in the 2013 and is still going on, people have fused, for example, the crab domain from zinc finger 10 to Cas9 and have shown that they can decrease gene expression. And we were wondering, can you find better repressors now that we have quite a menu of them? And so we proceeded actually more recently to test many of these repressors that we found in many contexts in different cell types, fused to Cas9, fused to RTTR, different promoters, that endogenous genes, that enhancers, and actually what came up at the top is crab domains. So the crabs are your best bet to use with CRISPR, though zinc finger 10 is quite low on the list of crabs, is actually somewhat unstable, so don't use zinc finger 10. Please do use like 471 zinc free or 705. Actually, other people have shown that zinc free is better than zinc finger 10. And here's kind of how it can make a big difference. So especially when you're using it with kind of wimpier DNA binding domains, such as the multiplexing Cas12, when you fuse it to zinc finger 10, it's kind of weak at repressing versus when you fuse it to one of these better crab domains, it really represses much better. And it's the same length of protein. It's just a slightly different amino acid composition. So why do these crabs work so well? How do they work? So crabs work by creating heterochromatin at the locus. They are actually evolved in vertebrates to target transposon. And the it was known about the crab from zinc finger 10, which is shown here, that it recruits this hub protein CAP1 that brings everything at the locus to remove active modifications such as acetylation and write repressive modification such as H3K9 trimethylation. So it just makes heterochromatin there, which as we know, is actually associated with epigenetic memory. And in fact, we do see epigenetic memory when we recruit CRAB at our reporter gene. So we can recruit CRAB for different durations of time. We can silence all cells, but when we release it, depending on how long we recruited it, we can get different levels of epigenetic memory from 20% to 80%. And we are wondering, is there something different at the end of the silencing about the chromatin structure in the cells such that they know how long to remember that they have been silenced? So we actually collaborated with Alistair Bodiger, who's at Stanford, to image this locus around where we integrated our reporter. So what we do is we light up each 5 kb segment with fluorescent probes to see where is that locus in cells. Then we strip, sort of like get rid of that fluorescence and light up the next 5 kb. And in this way, we can reconstruct the 3D trajectory of this locus around 30, like sort of a bunch of like minus 75 to 75, but really focus on minus 30 to 30 kb around the place where we have the reporter. And we can measure, as a simple measure here, the radius of iteration, which is like how compacted this locus is. And when we do that, what we notice is the more compact that the locus is at the end of the recruitment, at the end of silencing, when all cells are actually off, the more irreversible you get weeks later. So in this way, somehow the cells are able to take recruitment time of this CRAB domain, turn it into space compaction, 3D chromatin structure, and then later decode it as epigenetic memory in weeks later. And I'm not going to show that here, but I actually did look at the molecular mechanism behind this, and it seems like the compaction is really connected to spreading of histone methylation. And we actually use the cut and run kit from EpiCypher that was mentioned this morning. And then it weeks later, it actually gets converted to DNA methylation, which we measured with the EMC kit from NEB, also talked about this morning. And so this is a very cool principle, we think, for interpreting signals. And with that, I'm going to summarize to sort of tell you that we have this method for testing many protein domains, which we applied it to gene regulation, but to transcriptional regulation, but we are currently applying to RNA regulation now, but it can be applied to any signaling process. And then now we have a better, because we used it, we have a better classification of activation and repressive domains that we can use to build better CRISPR tools and synthetic transcription factor tools. And we kind of started looking at the general principles of both repression and activation, and it seems like many times they have to go through chromatin. And with that, I'm going to thank my lab at Stanford and the people in that are involved contributed more strongly to the work I presented today. And especially I want to thank our collaborators, Mike Basick and Alistair Bodiger, and all of our funding. Thank you.
Very interesting. I'm curious, how do you think about the cells that don't get repressed by CRAB or about the signal in general? Is this at that epigenetic mark level, there's just some leakiness, or is this in certain cells, the CRAB domain doesn't work for some reason, and so you don't get the repression?
The CRAB domain works in all of them because they are all, at the end of silencing, they are all silent. So they all, and on average, they're all compacted. But when you look at the single cell level, they are always exploring the entire space of sampling, both open and closed, with the bias towards closed, because it is, after all, a random polymer. But I think it's a stochastic kind of process that has to do with the spreading of the modification that has a certain dynamics and how efficiently you convert it to DNA methylation in this case. And because there are so many nucleosomes that are modified and they're constantly turning over, I think that the fact that some of them, this very reliable fraction that are silenced but do not remember, comes from kind of imperfect feedback of the histone methylation maintenance and imperfect conversion of that to DNA methylation. I hope that answers your...
Yes, thank you. Yeah.